Hey everybody. You may notice I'm in a slightly different setting. The sound probably sounds different. I don't know if it's going to be better or worse, but I'm out of town. But I wanted to go ahead and get this recorded and finish this up so that way on the 25th of October, when we're back, we're done with truly done with the 70s and Jimmy Carter, and we're fully in the 80s. So remember, online there's already some stuff up, some readings you're doing. There's already a lecture on the AIDS virus, HIV and AIDS. That may look familiar to about five or six of you because you were in my environmental history class last year. And when I recorded that, I remembered distinctly trying to make sure I recorded it so that it would work for both classes. So that way I wouldn't have to re-record it. So for a couple of you've seen it. I would personally still re-watch it. But if you have your notes from last year, you're probably fine. But for everybody else, if you didn't take that class last year, if I get, because I do get a little bit into the origins of the virus, and I would not be testing that. I may, expect you to remember that it comes from Africa initially, but I get a little bit deep into diseases, and that's really more environmental history. So anyway, make sure you do watch that before the final. But I want to go ahead and finish up our lecture on sharing screen as I'm talking. Make sure we finish up our lecture on Jimmy Carter and the hostage crisis. So let me go ahead and get this set up. Should be good in just a second. Okay. So, and I don't have my notes with me, so hopefully I won't blank them too much. I have a couple of things written down here to try to remember. So where we ended on class on Tuesday, we were talking about what has come to be known as the malaise speech, but originally was known as the crisis and confidence speech. And as I mentioned, initially was a very popular speech. And most people recognize he was absolutely right in what he was trying to say. And he was, and as I've said, I believe this speech could be given today in 2022 and it would still work. But after a few days, people began to flip on it. It kind of started with the media at first. Well, actually, it first started because he fired his cabinet, most of his cabinet. He was trying to do like a start over, but that looked weird and panicky. And then some of the media started kind of going back saying, hey, he's kind of blaming us, not himself, for these problems. And so it's interesting that over time, this has become sort of a notorious speech of a major mistake. But it wasn't intended that way, and it initially wasn't seen as that way. But this is kind of symbolic of, if you will, the downfall of the Carter administration. He will still make some pretty good accomplishments, but really, this is kind of the beginning of people turning on him. The hipness of Carter goes away after this. And there's actually one other thing, a very odd thing, that actually did play a role in this. Around this time, Jimmy Carter, who was a big outdoorsman, he did a lot of hunting and fishing. He actually did a trip down to Georgia, Southwest Georgia, and do some fishing. And of course, he's the president, so there's Secret Service there. Often the White House photographer does follow presidents around, And anyway, they captured this image. So Jimmy Carter later goes back, he goes fishing, and he goes back and he's telling a couple of people. He says, it was weird. I was in my boat fishing, and this rabbit, and he called it the swamp rabbit, just kept coming up to me. And I don't know if it's rabbit, because rabbits don't normally come up to you. So I just swatted it away. And the rabbit swam away. He just thought, whoa, what a weird thing. And somebody told somebody who told somebody, and eventually it made its way to the press. And again, this is pre-internet, so things went a little slower, but it appeared in a couple of newspapers. Because, there is something funny about the most powerful man in the world, the leader of the free world, being, quote unquote, attacked by a rabbit. I mean, it's just inherently funny. So this story kind of made the newspapers, and then it kind of became a little more prominent, a little more prominent. It was always meant tongue in cheek, but kind of like the malaise speech, the idea of President Carter being attacked by a rabbit kind of began to play into this image of Jimmy Carter as weak on defense, as just kind of a wimp. And this image, which started with this, but kind of, coupled with his religiosity and his gentleness and the wearing sweaters, I mean, his public image became one of sort of, again, kind of a Mr. Rogers type. And that actually emboldened some foreign leaders to do things they may not have done if they thought he was a wilder man, or a person maybe a little more quick to use the nuclear weapons or something. And anybody who's a Monty Python fan, you know that rabbits can be killers. here's a little scene from a movie made in Scotland called Monty Python and the Holy Grail. I'll just play a second of it.
Behold the cave of Caer Banoth.
Right. Keep me covered.
What with?
Just keep me covered.
Too late. What? There he is.
Where?
There.
What, behind the rabbit?
It is the rabbit.
You silly sod.
What?
You got us all worked up.
Well, that's no ordinary rabbit. Oh. That's the most foul, cruel, and bad-tempered rodent you ever set eyes on.
You tit. I saw my arm and I was so scared.
Look, that rabbit's got a vicious streak a mile wide. It's a killer.
Get stuck.
It'll do you a treat, mate.
Oh, yeah? Manky Scots git.
I'm warning you.
What's he do? Nibble your bum?
He's got huge, sharp... He can leap about... Look at the bones!
Go on, boys. Chop his head off.
Right, silly little bleeder. One rabbit, two coming right up.
Look!
So that's what Jimmy Carter saw. He was worried about the killer rabbits. Anyway, all right. So, and by the way, just to tie it in, that was a movie from 1974, a British film called Monty Python and the Holy Grail. So let's shift from killer rabbits to a real killer, the Shah. So Shah in Persian just means leader or king. I mean, that's really, when you hear Shah, S-H-A-H, think king. But whenever anybody in the West says the Shah, we really mean one person. That guy right there. Of course, you got Jimmy Carter right beside him. You have the Shah of Iran. And then you have Rosalind Carter. And then, of course, the wife of the Shah on the other side. So the Shah of Iran, and there's been many, but although this was the last one. But again, for us, when we say the Shah, this is who we mean. Muhammad Pahlavi, who first came to power in 1941. And ruled until 1979, but we could argue that his real power did not come in until 1953, but again, ending in 1979. And we'll talk a little bit more about the history of the Shah, Muhammad Pahlavi. I kind of wanted to start with the end, though. He was in power in the 70s. He was an ally of the United States going back to 1953, actually really going back to 41. But it turned out he was actually quite a cruel ruler. He tortured people, he killed people. And again, post-Watergate, not only did investigative journalism start looking at American leaders, but they also began looking at leaders that we dealt with. And, you know, the West had always turned a blind eye to Iran. Iran was an ally of ours up to that point. So we kind of didn't notice what they did, but news organizations began to pay attention in 75 and 76 and 77. One of these was 60 Minutes, which is still around today, but it was a huge news television show in the 1970s and 80s. It came on 7 o'clock Sunday nights, just as it still does. And they got interviews, especially in the 70s, they got interviews with everybody, including Muhammad Pahlavi, the Shah. So here is Mike Wallace. Some of you may know him, but if you don't know Mike Wallace, he's passed on now. You might know his son, Chris Wallace, who was on Fox News and now is on CNN. Anyway, here's Mike Wallace talking a little bit to the Shah about these accusations of his cruelty.
You're saying you do what every country does.
Sure.
If torture is necessary, you torture.
Not the torture in the old sense of torturing people, twisting their arms and doing this and that. But there are intelligent ways of questioning now.
Well, they talk about psychological and physical torture.
Physical, I don't believe.
I talk...
Not anymore. Maybe in the old days, maybe.
I talked just today to a man whom I believe who told about torture.
He was tortured?
Yes.
And you believe that he was tortured?
Yes.
How many years ago?
Within, I want to be very careful, not yesterday.
Ah, well, maybe. I don't know.
The word has gone out to stop it.
To stop what?
Torture.
But a long time ago, yes.
But the victims of Savak knew better.
They would tie the hands and feet.
Was that the Shahid?
and there would be some sort of a hotel.
You're saying you do what?
I'll go ahead and stop there. But again, you could hear, I mean, this is like a Hollywood version of a corrupt leader. What are you talking about? Torture? There's no torture. There's no torture? Well, a long time ago, maybe, I don't know, yesterday. But I mean, it's, you know, again, it was obvious he's fibbing. He's acting like he doesn't know what he's talking about. You know, so this was not a nice guy. Let's just put it that way. This was not a nice fellow. And keep in mind, up till 1979, we, the United States, were allies with him. I'm going to come back to that period. But I wanted to go ahead and give you the sense that this was not a good guy. So let's go way back. We have to understand a little bit of Western relations with Iran to understand what happens in 1979. So, of course, Iran is a very ancient civilization. It used to, was often called Persia. So in the nation of Persia, the kingdom of Persia, Britain was given permission to search for oil. You know, England was getting, the United Kingdom was getting ready to switch from coal power. Some of you in the environmental history class might remember how important coal power used to be, but they were beginning to switch their navy from coal to oil. Oil was starting to become the main fuel and the main way of making machines run. So British Petroleum, BP, which you see those stations all over in the US, they had a subsidiary, the England Persian Oil Company. This is part of BP. It later becomes known as Anglo-Iranian Oil Company. Let me go ahead and explain this real fast. So in the 1930s, Persia became known as Iran. The father of the Shah, Mohammad Pahlavi's father, Reza Pahlavi, who was also the Shah, he changed the name from Persia to Iran. And he said that part of the reason was is that Persian was really a Western name, that Iran was the name that they always called themselves. And that may be very well true, but there's also a second reason he did that, a little darker reason. So in the 1930s, Reza Pahlavi, the previous Shah, was allying his country very much with Nazi Germany. Now, technically, Iran was a neutral nation, but they were really aligned with the Germans. And Germans, of course, the Nazis, of course, talked a lot about the Aryan race. And of course, if you trace back the Aryan peoples, they do go through Persians. So he was really trying to say, look, Iran and Aryan come from the same word. I mean, it's basically the same thing. So this is also, I mean, there's a reason why it was the 1930s that he made that change. It was to kind of curry favor with Germany. Okay, so I'm just going to say Iran for now, and just to keep it simple. So 1901, BP, British Petroleum, British Kingdom, were allowed to explore for oil in the Persian Gulf and on the there. And then May 26, 1908, they did find oil. So I see the photograph about the time they found it. And it wasn't just that they found oil. I mean, this was really the largest deposit in the world. This was major, 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 major find. I mean, it's really hard to fathom how much money we're talking about, especially in today's dollars. So again, this was technically when the Asian Oil Company was formed, again, as a subsidiary of BP. Winston Churchill, later to be prime minister during World War II and also in the 50s, I mean, he's all over this. So he's the one that initially kind of sought this permission. Then once oil was discovered, he's the one that really pushed BP to do all of this. And he's also the one, he was in charge of the British Navy. And so he also is the one that switched from coal to oil. So again, he's all over these early efforts. So the way it worked is that the United Kingdom received most of the profits. I think Iran got little less than 20% of the actual profits, the money. And as for the oil itself, only 16% of the physical oil went to Iran. The rest went to the UK. And not only that, but there was a pipeline. I have a different image. So there was a pipeline. And there was one of these pipes was going to Iran. You know, here's your oil. And the British actually built a pipe off of that pipeline, the 16%, they built a pipe off of that, and they were still siphoning off oil. I mean, there's no getting around it. The British did not behave well. They were not honest players in this whole thing. The main area where this is happening, the oil refinery and where most of the British people live in, was Abadan, the city of oil. And it was a British-built town. Here is a modern day image of Iran, and you can see Abadan there on the left side, on the southern end, on the far left, you can see Abadan right there at the head of the Persian Gulf. And again, it was primarily British living in this town. The only Iranians you would have seen would have been things like servants and cooks and domestic workers, that sort of thing. So British is, you know, kind of building up Iran. It's not a colony of Britain. It is its own country, but at the same time, they're kind of like a colony, sort of. And Britain's, and US is getting a piece of this as well. Some of the American oil companies are getting a piece of this. So anyway, let's back up. 1941, Mohammad Pahlavi, the guy we saw talking about torture, he officially becomes the Shah from his father. So in 1941, because Iran was aligned so much with Germany, to the point that they were really an ally of Germany, Russia, who now was on our side, United Kingdom and US basically invade Iran. They're like, nope, you're not doing this anymore. The father abdicates because of this, and Mohammad Pahlavi, his son, becomes the Shah. And of course, he's primarily a figurehead. He doesn't, kind of like Queen Elizabeth was of England. She didn't really have real power. She did formal ceremonies, but he didn't really have real hands-on power in the same way that he will later. And again, some of you World War II buffs, you might remember the first meeting between Stalin, Churchill, and Roosevelt was in Tehran. And that was the summer of 41 because basically Iran was captured by the So I hope you're not hearing that. My email keeps going off. So if you hear a ding every 12 minutes, it's probably my email because I keep hearing it in my ears. All right. So things go on. The deal stays the same. Everyone's getting rich off this oil. Pahlavi's getting rich himself. He's living a wonderful life. Then in 1951, and this is something we're seeing across the world, especially in the former British Empire, places like Egypt, many countries in Africa, now in Iran, there is a big push for these colonies or countries like Iran that were very subservient to the West, wanting to understandably retain their own resources and keep their own oil. And one of these was a guy named Mohammad Mossadegh. Or Mossadegh. I've heard it pronounced several different ways. I'm probably going to say about three different ways as we go along here. But he was an anti-imperialist. He wanted to stop so much Western influence into Iran. So again, this is a parliamentary system, very similar to what Britain has. So the way it works in a parliamentary system, you may have a king, as in this case, or in England for so long, a queen, but then you have a parliament or a senate. And of course, there's various political parties there, like we have Democrats, Republicans, Libertarians, you know. And whichever party gets the majority, the leader of that party becomes the prime minister. So for instance, in Germany, although there it was called chancellor, we see Adolf Hitler become chancellor. Now, he didn't actually get elected to office, but the Nazi party became the majority party, and therefore Adolf Hitler became chancellor. That's exactly how it works. Like right now in 2022, it's Liz Truss, who is the head of Britain. Before that, it was Gordon Brown. Good Lord, that was a few years ago. It was Boris Johnson. And then it was, anyway, mine's going to go blank. I better quit doing that. But anyway, that's basically in Britain, that's what that is. It's whoever's the head of the party. So that's what happened here. So Mossadegh becomes the prime minister because his party becomes the official president. The majority party. So he's named prime minister. That's what PM is. In fact, this is the image of the Shah, Mohammad Pahlavi, shaking hands and naming Mossadegh. There's my three ways of pronouncing it right there. Naming him prime minister. Now, he was an odd guy, Mossadegh. He very much, you know, was a man of the people and wanted Iran to be its own country. He wasn't perfect by no means. He was a hypochondriac. He often conducted business from bed. He would constantly wear his pajamas around. And he had his own issues, as did a lot of these early leaders. So I don't want to pretend like this guy was a wonderful guy, but he was the democratically elected leader of Iran at this point, you know. And of course, what he wanted to do, and he did, was nationalize the oil, basically saying, BP, you're out. This is our oil. We're taking it back. it belongs to us. You guys, you know, yes, we gave you permission, but we're not taking that permission away. Not surprisingly, the UK and the US is not very happy about this. Britain's, and Churchill is now back as Prime Minister of England. He had been Prime Minister in World War II. He got voted out. Now he's back in. And he was there from the beginning. He is furious. To him, this is theft. He's like, we built this. We built all this stuff with our money. Of course, a lot of that money came from Iranian oil, but nonetheless, they consider this a huge slap in the face. And immediately, the prime minister gets labeled as a communist, because he is anti-West. Many in the United States and the United Kingdom say, well, he's obviously a communist, because if he's against us, he must be with the East, and meaning Russia and China. And the other thing was, because this is a democratic country, just like the United States and England, there were other parties, including a communist party, and that's the CP there. You could say it's a lowercase c communist party. It was very, very tiny, but it was allowed to exist, just like it was allowed to exist in the US and in the UK. Because of this and his anti-West stance, he was immediately labeled a communist. He is siding with Russia. Now, Truman was president at this point. Truman, by the way, hated the Shah, who you see here. But again, he was our ally. We had to do this. But he actually liked Mossadegh. He really thought he was a good leader. He kind of respected the elections. But others in the U.S. did not. And Churchill definitely did not. So 1952, Dwight D. Eisenhower, who had actually been a part of the capturing of Iran and was involved in all the World War II politics and was good friends with Churchill, he becomes president, and he agrees with Churchill that this is not a good situation and that the situation in Iran needs to change. And whether it's a fair election or not, the idea is that the issues are much bigger than Iran. We're talking Cold War. And of course, all's fair in love and war, right? That is the prevailing attitude. We are at war. That means we have to take actions we may not normally take. That's how they're gonna spin this. So a couple of brothers who happen to be Wall Street lawyers join the Eisenhower administration. One is, and I have these in order of the names. So Alan Dulles is on the left, John Foster Dulles on the right. So Alan Dulles is named the head of the CIA, and he will remain the head for several more years. And John Foster Dulles is Secretary of State under Eisenhower. And they agree completely about Iran. In fact, they're going to do, under Eisenhower's orders, they're going to do something about this. So essentially, there's a coup d'etat in Iran. On the outside, it was done totally by Iranians. But the reality was the United States and the United Kingdom were involved. In other words, we overthrew Mossadegh and put back into power the Shah. And instead of being a figurehead, he would be real power. So again, even though it is the United States UK doing this, it was not public and for decades before anybody knew we did it. And even then, you know, we can say today that the United States helped to overthrow the prime minister and essentially the government. We're not talking about an army. We're not talking about hundreds of people. We're literally talking about maybe five or six people total. On the U.S. side, again, it's amazing how a couple of people with a little bit of money and the right connections can make things happen. And it doesn't take many people to make these things happen. So we, the public, have known about this really since the Church and Pike committees of the mid-70s. That's when this first came out. And there were several books. I think Stephen Ambrose wrote the first book. And Stephen Ambrose, some of you may know him as a World War II historian. He died in the early 2000s, but his books still are selling well. But he first started out as an Eisenhower biographer, and he wrote a book in the 80s about Eisenhower's secret wars, his role with the CIA. I think that was the first book to actually really get into this. But in the last few years, I think this is 2013, this article was. So for the last 10 years, the CIA has been upfront about it. Most of the records are now, and there's not many, but most of the records are now declassified, and so we can see them. So this was the CIA on the US side and the MI6, their version, on the British side. And it was known as Operation Ajax. And of course, these names mean nothing. You know, Ajax is just a made up name. So in fact, today there's a computer that randomly comes up with these names for these secret plots and stuff. So again, this was the plot to overthrow the prime minister of Iran. And if you look at the newspapers, it's very clear. I don't know if my little dumb face is in your way or not, so let me move it. Like, this is the New York Times headline. It happens to have Eisenhower on the other side. Royalist oust Mossadegh, 309 Iranian fighting. Shah is flying home today to take power. So again, that's, as far as anybody knew, this is just people on the inside. And there were plenty of people that wanted the Shah back, don't get me wrong. But it was the United States that did this. Shah will assume dictatorial powers. I mean, basically, this is when his real power begins in 1953. And to kind of sweeten the deal, BP gives 25% of profits instead of under 20%. So they kick it up a little bit. Pahlavi gets a little bit himself, but it's still the rest of the profits go to the UK and the five major US oil companies. So in other words, UK has to share a little more of the US at this point. So we're getting tons of our oil from Iran. And just let me back up a little bit. Again, essentially what we're talking about is Alan Dulles and John Foster Dulles. With the sort of nod from Eisenhower, they set this up. I believe it was a guy named Derbyshire on the MI6. I think it's Norman Derbyshire. Then a guy named Stephen Mead on the CIA. They were the two agents in charge of this. They were given some money. They were on the ground already, so they knew the right people. They basically told people, hey, if you were to do this, we would not stop you. I mean, that's basically what they did. And also a guy named Kermit Roosevelt, the grandson of Teddy Roosevelt, drove from Iraq into Iran with a car full of money to pay off people and let people buy off supplies. That's really the US and UK's involvement. Again, there was no army involved. It was the US talking to the right people, giving a little bit of money, and essentially saying, if you were to do this, we will look the other way. So in a weird way, it's not that we weren't involved. We absolutely were. We were instigating. But sometimes I think when you actually look at how these things played out, it might be surprising how little and hands-on we really were. This is a weird analogy, but it's like I always talk about the Spanish conquest of the Aztecs, Hernan Cortes and 200 soldiers. And the part I always tell everybody that people forget is that it was as Spain and 200 soldiers, plus tens of thousands of Native Americans who were fighting with them. And, you know, so sometimes we kind of forget. And same way, there were Iranians that wanted the prime minister gone. So given the right permission and the right money, they were willing to do the rest themselves. So the Shah is the leader of Iran. I mean, he is the leader, even though they're still nominal prime ministers. And they were still our allies. So presidents like Nixon and Kennedy and Gerald Ford and, of course, Jimmy Carter had to meet with the Shah. They all despised him. They saw him for what he was. He was just a prima donna. He was a guy getting rich off his people. He was a torturer. But again, he was our ally. And we needed, other than Israel, they were pretty much our only ally in the Middle East at this point. When Jimmy Carter was first told he had to meet with him, he was furious, apparently. I would love to hear a recording of this, because people forget Jimmy Carter was a sailor. So he cussed like a sailor. And apparently, I'll edit myself, but when he was told about this, he said, I don't want to meet that a-hole. And of course, Jimmy Carter was all about human rights. The Shah was absolutely not for human rights. But he had to grin and bear it. That's why I like this image, because Carter does not look happy in that image. So why did we support the Shah? And this is the term we've used already, but I want to bring it back up, realpolitics. The word itself is a German word, but essentially the idea that, you know, it's Machiavellian, you know, that the end justifies the means, you know. So sometimes you have to put aside, again, this is something I think we always debate in politics. And when we talk about presidents, you know, going back to, say, Andrew Jackson or Thomas Jefferson and their behavior with Native Americans, or the way some presidents, you know, allowed for slavery, even if they were personally against it, or Jim Crow, or our role with allies, you know, it's, should they be totally moralistic and do everything, but then get, and do everything perfectly, but then get nothing done? Or should they sometimes play a little dirty, get their hands dirty, but then achieve goals? It's a tough call. I like to think I would keep my ideals, but I'm also not in power. I don't know what that would really look like. But we call this real politics. And the idea is you have to dance with the devil sometimes to get what you want. or to achieve a higher goal. Now, even though the Shah was a cruel leader, I mean, Iran was essentially a Western nation with great universities and capitalism. And unless you, as long as you didn't go against the Shah, you could actually live a pretty nice life in Iran. So I have several, I like this one because it's a lingerie shop. You know, you don't think of that in a Muslim country. So keep in mind, most of the country was Islamic, but again, unlike I think the modern day image of Muslims in the Middle East, you know, notice how they're dressing. You know, this is, a very Western place. You still have traditionals there, of course, just like always. And they have the freedom to be traditional. You have the freedom to be very modern. These are all images from about 68, 69 to about 79. And you got college students, women wearing jeans looking just like any other college student. But again, you do have the other side as well. In fact, you're going to eventually see some women when, and I'm jumping a little bit ahead here, when they are going to start being forced after 1979 to wear the turbans, to wear the headgear, the burqas. You do see women beginning to protest. And that's what you're seeing in these images, women not wanting to dress traditionally. They want the freedom to dress how they want to dress. But again, I think our image of the Middle East is one of deserts, hot sand, very traditional dress. This is more women protesting. I should have rearranged this. This is more women protesting the headgear and having to wear the headgear. But again, when we think of the Middle East, we tend to think of hot deserts, camels, turbans, burqas, and you forget. I mean, it's a very diverse area. In fact, Iran snows. You go skiing in Iran. It does have deserts as well. So it has real weather. It has a lot of diversity and culture, and especially at this point. So again, I think there's a lot of misinformation of how we tend to think of Iran today. So what changes? And this is where those images of people protesting, I should have put after this image. Again, there were problems with the Shah. And there were some Muslims that wanted to be more traditional Muslims. They felt that they had slipped too far to secular society, too far into Western society. And essentially, to put it in American language, they wanted more God and government. They wanted prayer in schools. That's why I always say, we've got to be careful what you ask for, because it depends on who the leader of that religious group, whether we're talking about Christians or Jews or Muslims, because once you start getting into religious leaders in charge, then they can get pretty absolute. But there was a big push for this, not by everybody, but there was a push for this. And that's when Imam Ayatollah Khomeini comes into play. He was actually in exile in Paris. He trained in Paris. He actually was actually quite Western. Up until the mid-70s, he didn't even have a beard. He dressed in Western suits, but he was a much more conservative Muslim leader. Imam, by the way, is, Imam and Ayatollah are both Islamic terms. Depending on whether you're Sunni or Shia, he's Shia. It can mean slightly different things. They both basically mean religious leader or prayer leader. But in the Shiite world, which is what he was, Imam is basically an infallible leader. It's basically you're just below the Prophet Muhammad. I mean, you're pretty much almost untouchable. So it's a big title. And Ayatollah in Iran, essentially, it's a 20th century term in Iran, and it basically means one of 12 Muslim Shia leaders. So he is like the top dog in the Islamic faith for Iran. So he's not just a nobody. He comes back to Iran and he leads a rebellion against the Shah, and eventually the Shah is overthrown and he becomes the supreme leader of Iran. And what very often happens with revolutions is that you wind up with something even worse than what you initially had. And of course, Mike Wallace gets one of the very first interviews with the Ayatollah Khomeini.
The Imam, President Sadat of Egypt, a devoutly religious man, a Muslim, says that what you are doing now is, quote, a disgrace to Islam. And he calls you, Imam, forgive me, his words, not mine, a lunatic. I know that you have heard that comment.
What do you mean by lunatic, madman?
That's what I heard President Sadat say on American television.
Yes.
That the Imam is a disgrace to Islam,
yes.
And he used the word a lunatic.
هست امام. آقای سادات رئیس جمهور مصر که یک مرد بسیار مذهبی و یک مسلمان هستش گفتن که با عرض معذرت از جسارت که گفته ایشون نیست.
سادات ادعای اسلام میکند.
سادات states he is a Muslim.
های اسلام.
And we are not. He is not, for he compromises with the enemies of Islam.
I'm going to go ahead and stop there. I just wanted you to hear at least a little bit of his voice, but also that, which cracks me up every time, is, first off, that's a classic move by Mike Wallace. I need to do that to people. I hear you're a jerk. Now, those are not my words. Those are those words. But, you know, if he's essentially calling the guy a lunatic. And I love that the translator is like, what? I don't want to say that to him. And, you know, you can tell he's the translator is actually scared to translate, which does indicate, gives you a sense of what this guy was like. This guy also tortured and killed and with a very cruel leader, much worse than the Shah, in fact. And by the way, you know, I talk about our images of the Middle East. When you say the Middle East to me, somebody who was alive when he first came to power, seven, I'm not going to lie, this is the image I think of. And he looks at me, he's got those demonic eyebrows. He just looks like a mean person. This is my image of the Middle East, even though it's not fair because there's so much more to the Middle East. But I'm one of those that he is who I think of when I think of Iran to this day, even though he's been dead since 1989. So he becomes the new leader of Iran. The Shah has been ousted. And again, Sharia law pretty much comes into power in Iran. This is when women have to now wear coverings. That's what they were protesting for. The universities change. Many people leave Iran as quick as they can. I actually had a couple of Iranian friends growing up who left during, in fact, I think the head of my class in high school was somebody who escaped from Iran at this point. Anyway, so Ayatollah Khomeini. And just to give you a sense of how little Americans really knew about Iran at this point, or any of the Middle East, the vice president of the United States, Walter Mondale, who was pretty sharp on stuff, when he was first told about this, his first reaction was, what the hell is an Ayatollah? I don't even know what that is. You know, like today to be in national politics, you know, in the cabinet, president, Senate, you have to know all of this stuff. But this is a time that when you really still could get away with not knowing about the Middle East. That had begun to change with the OPEC oil crisis. People started paying attention to those politics. But by 1979, you absolutely could not pay attention anymore and get away with it. Now, so that's one thing. How does it get worse? Well, the Shah is sick. He is dying of cancer. He really wants to come to the United States to get treatment. And Carter does not want, Carter hates this guy. He says, no, we cannot come over. We cannot enter the United States. It'll be a big problem, and I just don't want the guy here. Henry Kissinger, the Secretary of State under Ford and Nixon, in fact, I think you saw him in one of those images with the Shah, he and others call up Carter and said, you have to do this. You know, yes, he is a bad guy, but he is our ally. And we do not like this Khomeini guy, and we have to do this for him. He's done some stuff for us. You have to do it. So Carter reluctantly lets him in, and he comes to a hospital and eventually dies here. When news of that makes its way back to Iran. So again, think about this guy is a torturer. And even Iranians that wanted to stay very Western, they see images of the American presidents drinking with him, having dinner with him, laughing with him. Think about how they must feel about the U.S. A U.S. that primarily is not Muslim for the most part. And so when Khomeini comes in and says, those are our enemies, they're enemies of Islam, they're enemies of Iranians. And then you see the United States take in the Shah so he can get treatment. You can understand the anger that people felt. So at the U.S. Embassy on November 4th, 1979, a lot of protesters, in particular college students, showed up to protest. And it's a huge crowd gathers around the embassy. They eventually break in. They climb over the fence. There's a pretty good movie called Argos that actually has a couple of scenes that recreates this. And for time, I won't do it today, but if I remember, I'll try to upload those clips online, or you can find them on YouTube. That does a pretty good job of recreating just how intense this was. I mean, there were thousands of people gathered around this relatively small U.S. embassy with a very small staff. And eventually they break in. Some of the staff do manage to get away, but ultimately 52 hostages were held for well over a year. And back in 1979, you did not see images like this. It really is, I think, hard for us today. You know, there's been so much terrorism, including in the 80s and 90s, but obviously after 9/11, we have seen American journalists beheaded like Daniel Pearl. I mean, we've seen all kinds of stuff, and we've seen our own domestic terrorism. But in 1979, nobody did this to Americans. And here are Iranians who already have this otherness about them for a lot of Americans. You know, they're different. And I'm saying this is a good thing. This is kind of our own prejudice at work. They're Muslims. They're Middle Easterners. In fact, most Americans called them Arabs, which they weren't Arabs. They were Persians. You know, they're a separate culture. But still, there was already this otherness to them. And now they're doing this to Americans. And of course, when you're Jimmy Carter, when you're the president, this has happened under your watch. And it, again, I think it's hard for us today to understand just how angry Americans were about this. Now, again, one thing I do think is interesting is that they were held for 444 days. They were not tortured. They were not beaten. They were not killed. In fact, a couple are released for health reasons earlier. And they do all get released and they all survive. So it does have a happy ending in the end. So we're not quite seeing the level of violence and terrorism that we will see 20 years later, where they may have been beheaded. There's still a little more civility involved in this than we will see in later decades. So again, there is a huge anti-Iranian sentiment, not surprisingly, in the United States at this point. A country that most Americans had barely even thought about, now they become the new enemy. They're for about a year and a half, they were even worse than the Russians. So you might remember this earlier map I showed you of Iran, not this map, but an earlier map of Iran when I showed you the town of Abadan. You may have noticed that above Iran, it was the country of Turkestan. It noticed in 1979, it was not Turkestan. It was the USSR, the Soviet Union, in other words. So right on the border with Iran at that point was the Soviet Union. Of course, to the left was, which is west, was Iraq. The two countries to the east or the right are Afghanistan, and right below Afghanistan, you don't see it labeled, but it is Pakistan. So Iran is, which is a huge country. I mean, it's about four times the size of Iraq, by the way. It's a massive country. And it's right on the border with Russia. And right beside Afghanistan was basically a puppet of Russia at this point, meaning that Jimmy Carter's hands are pretty much tied here. He starts invading Iran. He's starting World War III. He starts bombing Iran. We're talking World War III. And already Russia has said, because Iran is still trading oil with Russia, although they're stopping to trade oil with the U.S. for a while, which guess what happens to gas prices? Russia's already said, do not invade Iran or we will consider that war. But I don't care who is the president. There is not much you can do at this moment without risking World War III. At one point, Jimmy Carter, against his best judgment, but he still gets the blame for it because he still ultimately made the call. There are some members of his cabinet that say, look, we can do it. We can send a mission into Iran. We can get these guys out. We'll call Operation Eagle Claw. We'll be in and out. He doesn't want to do it, but people talk him into it, so he does it. So again, it is ultimately Carter's responsibility. He initiates it. It's a disaster. They get bad intelligence. There's bad weather. The planes crash. A couple people die. The rest barely get out. It's a complete disaster. This is like the killer rabbit. You can't even do this. Look how weak Jimmy Carter is. This little country of Iran is slapping us around and we can't do anything. It looks like complete ineptitude. 1979 is actually a really interesting year. You could argue pretty strongly that 1979 is the year that our modern history really sort of begins. You know, like you want to understand 9/11, you want to understand the Middle East at this point, you want to understand both American and British politics. 1979, obviously here, Reagan is starting to rise in power, running for president. He represents this new form of politics, conservative politics. We also see conservatives rise in power in the UK. 1979 is when Margaret Thatcher became prime minister of Britain, the first female leader of the Western world, essentially. They've had several, Theresa May, Liz Truss now. We're a little behind on that one, but Margaret Thatcher is one of the beginning of this. She's the one that a lot of Americans tend to like, you know. But in Britain, particularly in Scotland, she is despised today. At one time, they liked her in Britain. Scotland has never liked her. She was a very different kind of leader. We'll talk more about her a little bit with Reagan. She's going to be a big player in the Cold War along with Reagan. I thought I'd play a little snippet of Margaret Thatcher because her rise to power is going to kind of echo what's going to happen in the United States with the rise of Reagan. They're not exactly the same, but they do share some. So this is a little video put together after she passed away a few years ago. It gives you a little taste of Margaret Thatcher.
Mr. Chairman, Mr. President, ladies and gentlemen, I stand before you tonight in my red star chiffon evening gown, my face softly made up and my fair hair gently waved. The Iron Lady of the Western world. Where there is discord, may we bring harmony. Where there is error, may we bring truth. Where there is doubt, may we bring faith. And where there is despair, may we bring hope. And to all the British people, howsoever they voted, may I say this. Now that the election is over, may we get together and strive to serve and strengthen the country of which we are so proud to be a part. To those waiting with bated breath for that favorite media catchphrase, the U-turn, I have only one thing to say. U-turn if you want to. The ladies, not for turning.
I couldn't stop there. I just want to give you a little taste. These were some of her famous lines that she said. You know, and she was tough. But so anyway, it's also 1979 was when the fascist leader of Saddam Hussein consolidated his power in Iraq. Now, what's interesting about the whole Iranian situation that in the 80s, Iraq, in our minds, became the good guys while Iran were the bad guys. Of course, now we know they both were not good. But Saddam Hussein, who had already been somewhat in power going back to the early 70s, again, kind of like the Shah in 53, consolidated that power. He became an absolute dictator, essentially a fascist leader at this point. This is from a really weird YouTube video. So I think if I remember right, there's some weird music and some weird subtitles. If this is the right video, don't worry about that. It was some of the best footage I could find. So the moment that Saddam kind of consolidated his power, he had a meeting with all the political leaders, including mostly his political enemies, all in a room. And one by one, he began to call out names. You know, I'm making these names up, you know, John Taylor. And then John Taylor would get up. Then the guards would take John Taylor, walk him outside. John Smith, you know. And as this is starting to happen, they realize, oh my God, these guys are going to be killed. And as that realization begins to set in, as they're slowly pulling these guys out, the crowd begins to react. And that's what you're starting to see here. Starting to applaud him. Stop there, but you can see what they're doing. As those people are beginning to be taken out, they realize we're all going to die unless we support this guy. So they all start yelling, long live, you know, blah, 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 you know. And that's how he did it. But there is one little thing you don't see in this video that I do want to talk about for a second is there's one last little touch to this. So they're all taken out. And then Saddam Hussein has the army come in and give the people in the room guns. And they are taken outside and they kill the others. So it's like a game thing. It's like, you're in it with us. I didn't make you kill him. You killed him. Actually, did make him kill him. Still, that's how Saddam Hussein ultimately consolidated his power. A very cruel leader who tortured his people. I mean, this is you know, we've already talked about Abu Ghraib. In Afghanistan, they were being controlled by the Russians. They had their own government. They were technically separate, but it was a puppet government of the Russians. So it was essentially a communist country. But most of those people there, traditional Muslims, of course, communism is anti-religion. They wanted, you know, the communists gone and the Westerners gone. And so these Afghans that fought back, we would refer to as the freedom fighters. And of course, it's always interesting in history, you know, one person's freedom fighters, another person's terrorists. I mean, we could even apply that to the American Revolution. We consider them freedom fighters, heroes, patriots. At the time, 1776, many British would have considered, you know, Patrick Henry and Thomas Jefferson and John Adams and all these guys as terrorists. But of course, these freedom fighters would ultimately evolve into groups like the Taliban and Al-Qaeda. And of course, on the right there, you can see Osama bin Laden, a Saudi Arabian who was helping the Afghans find their freedom. And again, he'll ultimately be the head of Al-Qaeda, who then does 9/11. But we were giving them weapons to fight the communists in Afghanistan. And we would continue to do that all the way until the late 80s. Finally, in late 1979, Russia, because Afghanistan was clearly slipping away and what was going on in Iran, they don't want being repeated in Afghanistan. You know, the Russians officially invade Afghanistan in late 1979. The biggest mistake Russia could have made at that point. This is their Vietnam, but it's much more worse than our Vietnam was just because when we talk about the fall of the Soviet Empire and the end of the Cold War, the one thing I think a lot of Americans forget is that it was the more than 10 years that Russia had spent in Afghanistan that demoralized the people, but also literally bankrupted the country. And I think if somebody's listening to this later than 2022, I may sound like a fool, but I think we're starting to see this with Russia's invasion of Ukraine. That seems to be a huge mistake on Russia's part. It's alienated much of the world, and it does seem to be demoralizing Russians and bankrupting the Russians. So we'll see. But it may be history repeating itself a little bit. So not only are all these things happening in 1979, but again, so much of it in some ways or fashion are revolving around Iran. So 1980 was the big Olympics. You know, Olympics aren't the same anymore as they once were. I mean, they used to be so much part of the Cold War. I mean, the Olympics used to be fun because you couldn't wait to see if we or Britain or France was going to beat the Russians or the Chinese because it was us versus the communists. And you know, the communists always cheated, which is partly true. They did used to give lots of steroids. Now everybody's doing that. But back then it was, they openly did it. So there was a big push for maybe the West to boycott the Olympics because of Russia's invasion of Afghanistan and to some degree their support of Iran holding American hostages. So boycotts of the Olympics happened several times between 76 and 84. There were several African countries that rebelled in 76. All the blue boycotted the 80 Olympics, which were being held in Moscow. And then, of course, Moscow and some of the communist countries boycotted the 84 Olympics, which is why that's the Olympics we won all the gold medals. And of course, that one was in L.A. And again, you might think, well, why does boycott the Olympics? Why is that a big deal? Well, because, you know, Olympics is where a country shows off itself. So Moscow was getting ready. It was almost a PR campaign for Soviet Russia. And the fact that we didn't go in and so many countries didn't go in, it ruined those Olympics. I mean, almost nobody talks about the 1980 Olympics. It's like it's almost like it didn't exist. And this is why. And even here in the United States, we start seeing a lot of anti-Iranian messages. I'm going to play, there's two videos here. The one on the left, I actually literally have this 45 involved. I have it in my office and I keep forgetting. I actually literally went out and bought this when I was a little kid. I'm embarrassed by this now because it's such an awful song, but it's called A Message to Khomeini.
Tell her, we know you call us yellow, and you'd like to see us crawling and bowing at your feet. You think you're so darn bad, but when Uncle Sam gets mad, there's gonna be an oil slick right where Iran used to be. Cause we could take our BB guns, blow your buns to the sun. Just our Boy Scouts could wipe you out. Someday soon, Khomeini, you'll burn one flag too many. Uncle Sam has got his pride, you're about to feel his clout. The Shah is our old friend, and we're proud to save his skin. And Khomeini, you can't blackmail the good old USA. We hope the sand you eat fills your stomach like our wheat. You can shove your oil up your only holy place.
All right, I played more than I meant to. I had a quick message, and I realized I was playing. So you get the message. I think it even says about Arabic in there. Not a very good song, and I only kept it because it's a collector's item now. Not proud that I had that. Here's another one. You've actually heard this before because I think John McCain played it a few years back.
Bam, 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 Iran. Bam, 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 Iran. Some rocks, tell the Ayatollah gonna put you in a box,
Bomb Iran. You know, and you really, it's funny, especially when you're mad at Iran, but you know, you really stop and think about it. First off, I mean, to make joking songs about literally bombing cities and children and women, I mean, not to sound like a killjoy, but I mean, to really, because I've said this before, and I can hear students go, oh, but like, I mean, it's really not funny when you stop and think about it. And of course, that's Bomb Iran, based on the Beach Boys song, Barbaran, Barbaran. But, you know, and being, you know, anti-Muslim, let's bomb a mosque, let's kill an Ayatollah. But again, even though they're silly songs, they were big hits, and they do demonstrate, they're a good illustration of the American anger at Middle Easterners at this point. So all of this is happening. There's massive changes in the world in 1979. And into this comes Ronald Reagan, a former actor. He never was a major, I mean, people knew who he was. He was never a major actor. He was a pretty decent actor, but you know, probably more famous for hosting a television show in the 50s called Death Valley Days. He was also a spokesperson for General Electric and hosted their show and went around speaking for them. And that's actually in the 50s when he became quite political. He started out as a Roosevelt Democrat, but dealing with the Hollywood Union, which he was the president of for a year, and dealing with GE, and he slowly began to change. And in the mid-50s, you started seeing this movement by people such as William F. Buckley and Barry Goldwater, a shift to a new political movement known as conservatives. Now, they mostly are embedded within the Republican Party. And today, people tend to link Republicans and conservatives as one group. But technically, they were two separate groups. You know, conservatives was a movement, not a party. But over time, it becomes very allied with Reagan. It becomes very allied with Republicans. This is when those two things come together. Barry Goldwater had run for president in 64 and lost. The only other conservative presidential candidate was capital C conservative was Ronald Reagan in 76. He challenged Ford, he lost. But now people are kind of ready. They're sort of sick of the Jimmy Carter sensitive, transparent side. They miss some of the toughness of the earlier presidents. And of course, with in particular the Iranian hostage crisis, but also the oil prices, rise in inflation, all the sort of uncertainty that seems to be going on in the world in 79 and 80. People are kind of looking for a change. And in the way Reagan obviously couldn't win 76 because he didn't, and Carter did, just the opposite is going to be the case in 1980.
The president promised that he would not increase taxes for the low and middle income people, the workers of America. Then he imposed on American families the largest single tax increase in our nation's history. His answer to all this misery? He tries to tell us that we're only in a recession, not a depression, as if definitions, words, relieve our suffering. Let it show on the record that when the American people cried out for economic help, Jimmy Carter took refuge behind a dictionary. Well, if it's a definition he wants, I'll give him one. A recession is when your neighbor loses his job. A depression is when you lose yours. And recovery is when Jimmy Carter loses his.
That's very classic Reagan. I mean, the whole definitions thing actually does matter. There's a huge difference between recession and depression. He knows that, but he's obviously setting up that line, which is a very effective line. I mean, everybody remembered that. And that's what Reagan was good at, was that little catchphrase. And it's a great line. I mean, there's no getting around it. And he, you know, and I mean this in all sincerity, because he was an actor, he was good at this. He knew how to deliver a line. He understood the camera, understood how to play an audience. And there's a lot of these little moments. A good example was what's known as the Nashua moment, is where it took place. There were several Republican candidates at this time, because they all knew that this was probably going to be the Republicans' year. Reagan was not necessarily a shoo-in. He was doing good, but he was not a shoo-in. George H.W. Bush, who had been the head of the CIA already, he had done quite a bit with the government at this point. He had been ambassador to China. He was a pretty strong candidate. And so, again, they were holding a series of debates. At one point, Reagan sort of says, hey, why don't you and I just debate? Bush is all about that, because then it pretty much tells everybody, hey, we're the top two candidates. But then Reagan, and there are some reasons for this, but Reagan decided to ask the other Republicans to go ahead and join them. And of course, they were very happy to, including people like Bob Dole. And so what this really did was put George Bush on the spot, because he was the one going, no, I agreed to one person, I didn't agree to all these. And it made him look terrible. And so there was a big dispute. I mean, the candidates have literally shown up to debate. Reagan and Bush are on the stage, and Bush is like, I don't want them out here. And Reagan gets really mad, because basically what happened was Reagan and the campaign ended up paying for this debate instead of the original sponsor, which was a newspaper. So you'll see a little bit of this, and you'll hear Reagan's big line. This is the only thing anybody remembers about this.
Sure, tried to get the other candidates to leave. They don't. The fireworks begin.
If we may have the first question from the Supreme Court for the question.
You asked me if you could make an announcement first.
And I asked you permission to make an announcement myself.
Would the sound man please turn Mr. Reagan's mic off for a moment?
Is this on? Mr. Green,
could you turn that microphone
off? You asked for me if you would... I am paying for this microphone, Mr. Green.
That's the line. And, you know, some of this was, some of it was real. He was getting aggravated, but he also knew, he kind of knew this was going to happen. So there was also a bit of, all politics is theater. He knew this was going to happen. So, you know, and it worked. I mean, this is what people remember. Like, this guy would not let Iran get away with it. This guy was, you know, and that's how elections work. It is these little moments that make these happen. This is another little moment. This is actually right at the end of the campaign, so I'm playing it a tiny bit early, but this one always cracks me up.
Indicator lost his cool, and even that turned out to be to his advantage. It was in San Diego, the last stop on the last day of the campaign. He's tired. There are problems with the lights, and there's a heckler that just won't quit.
There are cities in Michigan. There are cities in Michigan. Shut up.
That one was a little bit real. And then luckily the crowd liked it. All right. So even as late as October 1980, Reagan gets the Republican nomination. Carter gets the Democrat, which, by the way, I'm not going to get into this, but Teddy Kennedy, if you remember him, the leader of the Democrats in the Senate, he actually challenges Carter for the presidency, just like Reagan did in 76. And that's a huge thing that hurt Jimmy Carter. In fact, I would argue that if Teddy Kennedy had not done that, Jimmy Carter very likely would have won this election. Now, you're going to not believe me when you see the results. But even as late as October, Jimmy Carter and Ronald Reagan were very, very close. And it wasn't that far apart. Now, it's going to be very different once we get to the actual election. But part of that was the Reagan-Carter debate. And let me give you some advice. Anybody who wants to be president? First off, my first advice is don't run for re-election. Because re-election, the second term is when you always get in trouble. If you look at most of the major scandals, they're always the second term. Reagan will be no different, by the way. Clinton will be no different. That's also when, you know, again, things, if you did make a mistake, that's when people find out about it. So if you can get in and out like James Polk did, where he did everything he said he'd do, and get out of there, you're great. If you do run for re-election, second advice would be don't debate. Debates work poorly for sitting presidents. Part of the reason, we saw this with Gerald Ford, part of the reason is every single thing you say, everyone's paying attention to, everyone's focusing on. Every little utterance you say matters. And you can't be as free as you want to be because you're president. You also can't criticize because you're the president. It's your fault now. So you're very much hamstringed. Your hands are literally tied as sitting president. Thirdly, if you do run for re-election and you decide to have a debate, rehearse, 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 rehearse. One of the problems of being a president is everybody tells you yes, 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 you're the president. And you don't really want people criticizing. When you're just running, your campaign manager will criticize you. But once you're president, they're scared to talk to you. This is going to affect Reagan too, by the way. His first debate on re-election, which he'll win, went horribly. People forget that his first debate was terrible. It was the second two debates that went really well. So getting back to Carter. So Carter is running for re-election. He agrees to one debate in October, which again, going against Reagan's tough, because Reagan, he lives for this. He lives for talking to the people and talking to the camera. It doesn't even matter what he says half the time. It's, even in this image, it's hard not to look at Reagan. He's smiling. He looks engaging. Carter looks so serious and looks like a fish. It's just, but Carter rehearsed one time and only for a few minutes. He got up there. And the way it always works is, you know, they have a setup at the White House and you have people that are shooting you questions. And you have somebody playing your opponent. And of course, they're playing it for real. So they're really criticizing you. And Jimmy Carter apparently for a couple of minutes got criticized. He just went, hell with this. I'm out of here. And he left. So he didn't rehearse for this, and he paid a huge price for this. Ronald Reagan says he didn't rehearse for his first, and he did not do well. Donald Trump, if you remember, just in 2020, his first debate was horrible. I remember, in fact, I hate that this happened. Biden told him to shut up. I'm not a big fan of that kind of politics. But Biden told him to shut up at one point because Trump literally would not quit talking. And I remember watching it with students at Bainbridge's campus, and there were like 100 students in the room. And when Biden said that, the whole room laughed and cheered. And most of that room were Trumpians. Most of them supported Donald Trump. But he was just, you know, he didn't do that in the next debate. He only did that the first one. Again, sitting president, didn't rehearse, you know, a little too cocky. We see this over and over and over again in politics. It's not unique to any one of these people. All right, I'm going to play just a little bit of the debate, a little bit of Jimmy Carter than Reagan. And again, I'm playing it so you can hear Reagan's famous comment at the end.
Governor Reagan, as a matter of fact, began his political career campaigning around this nation against Medicare. Now we have an opportunity to move toward national health insurance with an emphasis on the prevention of disease, an emphasis on outpatient care, not inpatient care. An emphasis on hospital cost containment to hold down the cost of hospital care for those who are ill. An emphasis on catastrophic health insurance so that if a family is threatened with being wiped out economically because of a very high medical bill, then the insurance would help pay for it. These are the kind of elements of a national health insurance important to the American people. Governor Reagan, again, typically is against such a proposal.
Governor, there you go again. When I opposed Medicare, there was another piece of legislation meeting the same problem before the Congress. I happened to favor the other piece of legislation and thought that it would be better for the seniors.
the line was, there you go again. And he'll use it again in 1984 against Mondale. And that's the one line, which is very typical of debates. Usually it's one or two lines that everybody remembers. Nobody remembers the whole two-hour debate. And that's the line everybody remembered. And even in that clip, again, it's really hard not to look at Reagan. I mean, he looks great in the suit. But my last piece of advice, and I say this a lot, smile. It is amazing how many politicians don't smile and make jokes. And you look at presidents who usually win, even if they're saying angry stuff. Donald Trump's a great example. He says a lot of angry stuff, but he makes jokes. He's funny. People who don't smile tend not to get elected. So super serious, super, you know, again, Jimmy Carter didn't smile as much in 80 as he did in 76. But again, it's hard. He smiles. Reagan is engaging. He's got these little one-liners. And by the way, the other thing is, this is 42 years ago, and yet, what are they arguing? Healthcare. The exact same stuff we're still arguing all these years later. So the debate killed Jimmy Carter. He came off horrible in it, and I'm not saying he absolutely would have won without it. He was already weakened by all these things, but the debate did him absolutely no favors. And after the debate, Reagan's poll numbers shot up, and they never went back down. And it was only a few weeks from the debate, from the election anyway. It's a pretty bad blowout. 84 is going to be worse, but as you can see, Carter does get a few of, I mean, he gets Hawaii, and he gets, of course, Georgia, and he gets a few other states, but for the Rhode Island, but for the most part, he is blown out of the water. You look at those electoral votes, 489 to 49. The popular vote was a little closer than it might appear on the electoral votes, but it's a massive blowout. It is a direct rejection of Carter's policies.
I promised you 4 years ago that I would never lie to you. So I can't stand here tonight and say it doesn't hurt.
But in many ways, Jimmy Carter's job wasn't quite done, even though he had lost the election. He's still president until January. So before the election and even into the election. And the sad thing is he couldn't talk about this because it was secret deals. If he could have talked about this, he might have been able to win. And if he could have pulled this off before the election, he probably would have won. But he does work out a deal called the Algiers Accords, where Iran will return the hostages unharmed. We had frozen Iranian assets in our banks, $8 billion. We agreed to unfreeze those assets. And January 19th, it is settled, the day of the inauguration, and they are freed. And Reagan, to his credit, did indeed allow Jimmy Carter to be the one to meet with them. But Iran did one last little dig at Jimmy Carter. They didn't officially release the hostages until the moment Ronald Reagan took the oath, then they released them. And so again, that day, that evening, they did officially come home. And they did come home unharmed. I mean, it was resolved peacefully. And I think Jimmy Carter actually does deserve some credit for the fact that he was able to achieve this. There is one last little bit of Carter I do want to talk about later, the Camp David Accords, but that's later, because I'm going to tie that in with a later lecture. But I do think this is actually is an achievement, but yet it's the very thing that very much hurt him as president. There's still a contentious relationship with Iran and the United States, although the people themselves, it's not really quite as contentious as I think we imagine. You can still see this graffiti in Iran, but yet most of it's historic sites now. They're 40, 45 years old now, a lot of this graffiti. And again, the 1980s will be dominated by the Iranian-Iraqi war, and we will sort of side with the Iraqi side. So it's ironic that later we go to war with Iraq, not Iran. I'll do this in class. Sorry, I forgot. I had this weird little popular culture thing, but I'll do this in class. Okay, that's enough. So let me go ahead and stop the share. And I'll go ahead and let you guys go. So I'll see you guys on October 25th. See you guys later.